is bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. Each radiant cloud that opens, each vibrant bird that sings, God made
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Also with you.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this, the sixth Sunday after Pentecost. Today we welcome Archbishop Linda Nicholls, Primate of the Anglican Church of Canada. Welcome, Archbishop Linda.
Thank you very much.
And thank you for coming north to Orangeville. Usually bishops and archbishops visit in the winter and we arrange snowstorms for them, but today we've got some lovely warm weather and we welcome you to Orangeville and to St. Mark's. This is a banner month as well for St. Mark's, as three couples in our parish are all celebrating their 60th wedding anniversary. And so we give thanks for the 60th wedding anniversary of the Coplands, the Moyers, and the Spears, all in this month. God's blessings to them. And so we continue with the Collect for Purity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you. May we find peace in your service, and in the world to come, see you face to face, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and of death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and to deal with sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, so that the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh. You are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies, also through his Spirit that dwells in you. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among the thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but cares of the word, and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, in another 30. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May the words of my lips and the thoughts of our hearts be now and always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. First, let me say it's a joy to be with you here at St. Mark's in Orangeville. One of the curiosities of the pandemic is it has allowed me to be present with congregations across the country that I might not have had an occasion to visit for some time. either by video from my living room, or in this case, being able to be physically present with your clergy here at St. Mark's itself. Blessings and greetings. There is a popular story often attributed to indigenous teachings, possibly Cherokee. It is a story about a young man and grandfather in conversation. And the young man says something like, "I feel like there are two wolves fighting within inside of me. One that's drawing me to do what is wrong and one that draws me to do what is right. Which one will win?" And the grandfather sits for a moment and then looks up and says, "The one you feed." I think that quite well sums up the life in Christ that is described by St. Paul in our reading from Romans 8. Continuing the readings from the last few weeks and on into the next, in which St. Paul talks about the life in the Spirit and life in the flesh. In last week's reading, St. Paul cried out, "What I do not want to do, I do, and what I want to do, I do not." There is this tension within. And it's not a tension that says that the flesh or being human or being embodied is bad, for we are incarnational beings. We are beings given life, made in the image of God, and called to live out that life in this material world with the gift and the help of the Spirit. And so Paul can say at the beginning of our reading today, "There is now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus." We're called to live out that life in the Spirit here and now. And that is a daily challenge. It is a challenge to see the world as God sees it, moment by moment, day by day, and respond to the world, to all of creation, to the people around us, to our own heart desires and needs, through that way of living and not another. It is to continually feed the wolf of love, grace, compassion, forgiveness. And to remember that sometimes, unconsciously and consciously, we feed the other one. Or it is fed by all that is around us. For we live in communities and families and societies that feed selfishness, prejudice, fear, hatred. And we don't have to look far for that. I have been quite flabbergasted and dismayed when I hear people say, "I don't have to wear a mask. Why should I have to wear a mask? It's my right and my freedom not to wear a mask." Or when we see the pressures of communities and history that have led to acts of violence and racism. I know that I have been on a steep learning curve about attitudes and assumptions that I have drunk in deeply in my lifetime. Certainly, as I've begun to learn more about working with Indigenous communities and peoples and understanding our history in Canada, why do I always assume that the North American emphasis on efficiency and expediency is best, and that storytelling is a waste of time? Of course, we've seen it all around us. Just a day or so ago, our province of Ontario has announced that they will stop streaming students between vocational and academic streams in high school because for some reason, black and brown students populate the vocational schools at a much higher rate, which has no connection to their capacity or ability. We live in the midst of pressures and attitudes and social ideas and assumptions that are constantly changing and shifting. We've been shaped by history and events. I know that my parents were shaped deeply by growing up during the Depression, and I still wash plastic bags. I know that those who lived through the Iraq and Afghanistan wars carry deep scars and pain and prejudices. Those that lived through 9/11 live with the fear of terrorism. And of course, now we all share the experience of COVID-19. We've been shaped by family, by the attitudes of our parents, by their strengths and weaknesses. If you grew up in a violent or alcoholic home, you carry the scars of that in your own life. Or if you lived in a home that was filled with love and compassion and grace, if you lived in a home that focused on athletics, if you lived in a home that focused on music, those things have shaped and formed you. Like potter's clay, we have been shaped. And as we mature, we have to ask ourselves whether those commitments are consistent and good, to ask whether those things that have shaped us are feeding the right wolf within us. Jesus spent 3 years forming and shaping the disciples, helping them to see their faith and their world through the lens of love informing the law, and to stop feeding the assumption that they were not good enough, that sin broke the law and then they were done, and start feeding them from a perspective of that forgiveness. And 3 years was hardly enough. Even at the end, they did not yet see clearly. They were shocked when Jesus spoke to women. They misunderstood his actions. They tried to interpret him within the framework of their expectations of a Messiah who would free them from Roman occupation, not free them internally and in their relationship with God. And even at the end, in Gethsemane, they tried violence as the way forward. They needed the Spirit to shape their thoughts and hearts, as after the resurrection, they needed help in remembering what Jesus had said and taught. To live in Christ, as St. Paul so clearly calls us to, is to feed the wolf of God. And how do we do that? We do that through all the ways articulated in our baptismal covenant. To read the scriptures. To be fed by the body and blood of Christ. To pray, to practice repentance and forgiveness of ourselves and others, to love neighbor as self, to look for the dignity of every human being, to seek justice and peace, and to care for creation. It is through those practices that we feed the heart and soul so that it is shaped and formed for God's kingdom. And so we're called to be open to seeing and hearing afresh. And I know how difficult that can be. Last year, during the primatial election, I heard a rumor that I was being accused of being racist. And everything in me cried, no. And I tried to find out what I had said or done that had led to that accusation. And in the end, I came to realize that it wasn't any one particular thing that I had said or done. I needed to see my relationships differently to see how assumptions I had made were shaped by colonialism and not renewed under God. That my resistance to some changes or some different ways of doing things needed to be questioned. And to recognize that I've benefited from the embedded racism in our Canadian society as a white settler, and that unless I stand firmly against them, I participate and support them, even unconsciously, even silently. And so it spurred me to make dismantling racism a priority for our church, for our Council of General Synod. We've begun that work at every one of our meetings and will continue it through not only this triennium, but in every triennium, because this is work that will take us generations. To ask ourselves what barriers and attitudes keep us from enjoying the fullness of the gifts of all God's people, Indigenous, Black, Asian, all made in the image of God. So why do we privilege those who are North American or European first? So I am grateful with St. Paul that the Spirit of God in Christ is within us, is a guarantee to us, so that every day there is the possibility of listening afresh. We heard also the parable of the sower and the seed. It is a wonderful parable that you can come back to over and over again, because you can ask yourself, are we the soil? Is it the receptiveness of the soil that gives the seed its fruitfulness? What is it we need to do to make the soil in us ready to hear the word, to recognize it, and not allow it to be stolen or rejected for others? Are we the gardener, being sure that we daily practice those things that will nurture in us the capacity for the seed to grow, to water and feed the right wolf? Or are we the sower, being called to indiscriminately and generously share the love of Christ to those who receive it well, and those who reject it, and those who do not want it, and those who we don't think want it but may well receive it, to be generous in simply scattering it everywhere so that there's the possibility that the fruitfulness will come? There is now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. To everyone, that is the call, that we have a freedom to be transformed. For when we are wrong, when we sin, when we break relationship, when we give in to the other wolf, when we feed it far too much, we always have the opportunity to repent and return to the Lord, to not be condemned. And our baptismal life is a lifelong journey of shaping ourselves even more richly into the image of Christ in this world. In a few weeks, we will hear my favorite verse of Scripture, which is at the end of Romans chapter 8. I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. With that promise, that guarantee that nothing can separate us, and with the call to feed the wolf within us with love, compassion, mercy, and grace, and then feed the world, it is a promise that can and will be fulfilled 30, 60, 100-fold. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Our service continues with the Nicene Creed. Let us confess our faith as we say, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray. The flowers on the altar are placed to the glory of God and in thanksgiving for the Anglican Church in Canada. We give thanks to God for the 60th wedding anniversary of Jim and Mark Coupland, June and Lee Moyer, Janet and Harold Spears. Loving God, we ask for the gift of your Holy Spirit to help us to pray as we ought. The response to Holy Spirit is help us. We pray for Linda, our primate, and our Metropolitan Archbishop, and for Susan, our bishop, and for all ministers of Christ's Church, that they may be strengthened by the Holy Spirit in their preaching the good news of salvation. Holy Spirit,
help us.
We ask for the energy and vision of your Spirit, for those who are tiring in the battle against injustice and oppression, for those exhausted by the struggle with poverty and hunger. Holy Spirit,
hear us.
We ask for the hope and comfort of your Spirit, for those whose lives are overshadowed by illness or pain, for those whose lives are darkened by sorrow or bereavement. This week we pray for Cynthia and Andy, Johanna, Ryan, Bill, Elizabeth, Lee, Kristen, Canon Richard and Deacon Jane Rokeby, Jeff, Michael, Kay, Samantha, Sue. Holy Spirit, help us. Holy Spirit, we ask for the peace and joy of your Spirit, for those living in the shadow of war and violence, for those eaten up by guilt and anxiety, and whose Christian life has become hard and dry. Holy Spirit,
hear us.
We ask for the guidance and strength of your Spirit, for those uncertain how to use their time, talent, and gifts, for those tempted to do what is wrong. Holy Spirit,
hear us.
Loving God, we ask for the assurance of your Spirit, to know your presence with us in our daily lives, in our relationships, in our work and service, in our worship, in our times of joy and pain. Holy Spirit,
hear us.
In Jesus' name we pray, amen. As the Savior taught us, let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We continue to be grateful for those who support the church with their pre-authorized giving or by snail mail or e-transfer. Let us pray. Father, your word creates in us a yearning for your kingdom. Receive all we offer you this day and keep us in your peace for the sake of Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen.
God grant you courage to scatter the seed of the gospel wherever you may be, to nurture the soil of the seed in yourself, that it may grow and be fruitful. And God grant you joy in proclaiming good news wherever you may be. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen.
And now we look forward to hearing from Tracey for the Lion's Tale.
Hello, Lions. I hope you had a good week. It's certainly been a hot one. You might remember that we've been talking about the books in the Bible and how those books are split into two main sections, the Old Testament and the New Testament. The first four books of the New Testament are called the Gospel. In class, we've often repeated their names together, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and, yes, John. They tell us about Jesus' life, work, death, and resurrection. Book 5 is the book of Acts. Its full name is the Acts of the Apostles, which is another word for the disciples. It might have been written by Luke and talks about the work the apostles did to build up the church after Jesus went up to heaven. In the book of Acts, we learn about a man named Saul. Saul shows up as a really mean guy who hated these followers of Jesus, the Christians, and did just about everything he could to be the worst bully to them ever. He was responsible for having a number of Jesus' followers thrown into jail. But here's the thing. Even though Saul was awful to Jesus' followers, Jesus still loved him. Remember, Jesus loves everyone, even people who behave very, very badly. After being super mean to the Christians in Jerusalem, Saul went on his way to Damascus, a nearby city, intending to get more followers of Jesus into trouble. But something happened on the road to Damascus. There was a big flash of bright light, and Saul and his men all heard a big voice. They fell in fear. The voice said, "Saul, Saul, why do you hurt me?" Saul didn't know what was happening. He couldn't see who was talking. "Who are you?" he said. "I am Jesus, who you are bullying and mistreating," the voice said. "I have a plan for you. Go into the town and wait." Saul staggered to his feet and discovered that he had a new problem. He couldn't see at all. Jesus, it seems, had taken his sight. I think it got Saul's attention. I think that was the plan. With the help of his men, Saul got to the town, and his sight was restored by a man named Ananias. Saul could see again. Even better, he could now see how bad his earlier behavior had been, and so he changed his ways. He joined the disciples, although they were a bit nervous of him at first because they remembered what he was like before. But he had changed forever. Jesus had changed his heart. Saul got baptized and became known as Paul. He served God for the rest of his life. In his new life, Paul visited many places and told people about Jesus. He wrote long letters to Christian communities in cities like Corinth, Ephesus, and Rome. And it was his letter to the Romans that makes up Book 6 of the New Testament. In fact, his other letters make up almost all the rest of the books in the New Testament. He had a lot to say. Paul wrote his letter to the Romans to explain to them who God is, who we are as people, and what God has done for us through Jesus' life and resurrection. And he wrote it out in a way that puts the whole Bible together. Paul gets that it's hard to be a regular person and live in this world the way God wants us to. But he reminds us that we have to keep trying every day. We have to remember that we are saved by the love of God and not by our own accomplishments. In other words, we don't have to do anything to earn God's love and forgiveness except to try to live the way God wants us to. Our prayer today is this. Dear God, help us to focus on loving people, even the Sauls of the world, to show them forgiveness, compassion, and to watch ourselves for fear, hatred, and selfishness in our behavior and in our thinking. Thank you for giving us the story of Saul, who became known as Paul, to remind us that it's about how much effort we put into getting to know you now and where we put you in our lives that matters. Help us to remember to ask, what would Jesus do if we get stuck? And please help those Christians living in places in the world today where there are still people who are mean to them. Thank you. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.